Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this event. We're delighted to have you with us this afternoon. To welcome Evan Wolfson from Freedom to Marry. Before I do the introductions, I think I'll do the introductions after we see the video, if that's okay. I'm looking for my. I'll do the introductions after the video, but it is a real pleasure and a joy to welcome Evan Wolfson to the Humphrey School of Public Affairs at the University of Minnesota. I need to say something. I think I have to say it publicly that Evan Wolfson and I went to summer camp together. I don't know together, but we were in the same bunk. 50 years ago. And so you could say, well, you were, 8 years old. How can you remember somebody from a summer camp 50 years ago? I don't know the answer to that question. There may be two or three people who I remember from summer camp 50 years ago, and Evan was one of them. So when I read about the Freedom to Marry movement and his accomplishments, in that respect, I thought, well, geez, I can kill two birds with one stone. I can have Evan Wolfson come to the Humphrey School, and we can talk about Camp Tri-Woody, which we did 50 years ago, but also we can have a really valuable exchange on really sort of a critically important, whatever your political views, a critically important social, political, and legal movement. So we're very much looking forward to an interesting conversation this afternoon. So before I do introductions, I'm going to introduce a video which, on behalf of that Freedom to Marry has produced, and Evan has asked us to show at the beginning of this session, which we'll do, and then I will come back to the podium, do introductions. And then we'll have the conversation. So if we could start the video.
Progress on this journey often comes in small increments. explanation that love is love.
People learn that through their kids and their cousins and their friends, who were human beings like everybody else.
This was our journey. Together with a movement of many, a shared strategy we stuck to. A campaign to drive that strategy and spearhead that movement. We learned, we built, we rebounded, we kept going.
This morning, the Supreme Court recognized that the Constitution guarantees marriage equality. As the consequence of the countless small acts of courage, millions of people across decades who stood up, who came out, willing to endure bullying and taunts, and stayed strong, and came to believe in themselves and who they were, and slowly made an entire country realize that love is love. What an extraordinary achievement. What a vindication of the belief that ordinary people can do extraordinary things. Those countless, often anonymous heroes, they deserve our thanks. They should be very proud. America should be very proud.
Love won. We all won.
Well, when we discussed, when Evan and I discussed his joining us here, he expressed a strong preference for a conversation rather than a talk as such, and which seems appropriate because I think we all have an interest in learning more about the thinking behind this really significant set of developments over many years and many decades. That emerged, so we're told, from a paper that received a B grade at Harvard. But I think that's part of a great tradition in our country. Of course, the woman who designed the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, I think her paper got a B or a C, I think. in any event, I think we're delighted to host this conversation, and we're going to ask Sasha. Aslanian, a correspondent and producer for American Radio Works, the national documentary unit of American Public Media, to join us and begin the conversation with Evan. In 2001, when Sasha was working as a Metro reporter for NPR News, she asked for the assignment to cover the 2012 marriage amendment and followed the story through passage of the marriage through the passage of the legislation in 2013. As part of that coverage, she produced a documentary looking at the 40-year battle over same-sex marriage in Minnesota called The Deep Roots of the Marriage Debate. She produced a 20-minute instant documentary that ran a few days after the defeat of the amendment that explored how Minnesotans united for all families won its campaign. Her coverage of the marriage amendment won a national award from Public Radio News Directors Incorporated and a collaboration she did with Care 11 News that examined how the marriage debate was playing out in five cities in greater Minnesota, won a regional Emmy and a Walter Cronkite Award for Excellence in Television Political Journalism. So we're delighted that Sasha has agreed to join us this afternoon. Evan Wolfson is the founder and president of Freedom to Marry, the campaign to win the right to marriage nationwide. In 1983, he wrote his Harvard Law School thesis on the Freedom to Marry issue during the 1990s, the paper, I guess, that got the B. During the 1990s, he served as co-counsel in the historic Hawaii marriage case that launched the ongoing global movement for freedom to marry. He earned a BA in history from Yale University in 1978, served as a Peace Corps volunteer in Togo, and wrote the book Why Marriage Matters, America, Equality, and Gay People's Right to Marry. Citing his national leadership on marriage and his appearance before the U.S. Supreme Court in Boy Scouts of America versus James Dale, the National Law Journal in 2000 named Evan one of the 100 most influential lawyers in America. The Daily Beast dubbed Evan, and I quote, the godfather of gay marriage. There's an image there that just doesn't fit, but nonetheless. And Time magazine named him one of the 100 most influential people in the world. In 2012, Evan received the Barnard Medal of Distinction alongside President Barack Obama. So why don't we welcome both of our guests to their chairs, and we'll look forward to an interesting discussion. Let me also invite, as I understand it, Sasha, we're going to be collecting questions, so half an hour in or when you think it's appropriate, we can go to questions from the audience as well.
Great. Yep, they'll be passing out cards so you can write and then pass those forward. So start thinking what questions you want to ask.
That's right. Because it's being recorded, we're going to be doing it that way.
Yeah. Hi, Evan. So I thought that since we're here at the University of Minnesota, where a significant part of the story begins, when in 1970 law student Jack Baker tried to marry his partner Michael McConnell, who was a librarian at the U. In 1972, the U.S. Supreme Court declined to take their case for want of a substantial federal question. So you had your work cut out for you when you drafted your legal strategy at Harvard Law School in 1983. So what needed to happen in order for that to become a substantial federal question?
Well, Jack Baker and Michael McConnell, as you mentioned, were really the first couple, and there were several couples around the country who, in that very dawn of the modern gay rights movement, which we often erroneously date to Stonewall in 1969, within just 3 years, Baker and McConnell and these other couples across the country were bringing cases seeking the freedom to marry. So gay people have always wanted the freedom to marry. The quest for the freedom to marry has always been part of the movement. But as happened with Baker and McConnell, happened with all these other cases in that first wave of litigation, the courts were not ready, the country wasn't ready, the conversation hadn't happened. And the courts, including the Supreme Court, rubber stamped the discrimination and basically laughed these couples out of court. So what needed to happen was not just come up with brilliant legal arguments, because these couples had already made the right legal arguments. They already had invoked the Constitution. What needed to happen is we, as a movement, had to get the country ready. We had to create the climate in which decision makers, including judges, including the justices, would be able to see how this clear command of the Constitution, the command of equal protection under the law, the command of respect for the freedom to marry as a fundamental right, how these clear constitutional commands applied to these people, gay people. It wasn't a matter of coming up with a new argument or writing a better brief or being smarter. It was a matter of changing the hearts and minds and the political climate in the country so that the decision makers, including the judges, would have the courage and the clarity to do the right thing. And that piece of work, that creating the climate, that changing hearts and minds, took 4+ decades. This wasn't an overnight victory. It didn't just happen with one battle or one case or one idea or one person or one methodology. It took a movement of millions of people, millions of conversations, millions of dollars invested, many organizations, many pieces of work, many battles over many decades. But at the same time, it wasn't just a movement of random episodes. It wasn't just a bunch of things that happened. This movement had a strategy. Now, not everybody in the movement necessarily knew there was a strategy. Not everybody was acting according to a strategy. Not everybody necessarily would have agreed with the strategy had they known what it was. But there was a strategy that drove a critical mass of players to pull together and do the things that were needed and to leverage the power of this movement of millions. And driving that strategy was a campaign, Freedom to Marry. And so it was that combination of a movement, a strategy, and a campaign that was able to shape the climate to enable the courts, ultimately, to see what the American people came to see, how right these couples were back in the 70s when the Supreme Court had thrown them out.
And what did you do to get from, say, 25% public support up to 50, and then that was a different battle than going from 50 to 60%. So can you describe sort of how you were able to build that support?
Yeah, so I mentioned a strategy. So the strategy we set out to drive and to build and to follow and to get others to bring their pieces to was very simple. It derived from the lessons of history and from the law and how we could achieve this change. We wanted to win the freedom to marry nationwide. We knew that the way we would do that was by getting the Supreme Court to do what it refused to do in 1972, affirm the freedom to marry and apply it to loving and committed gay couples. That strategy, that goal of winning through the Supreme Court, meant that we did not have to win every single person, and we did not have to win every single state. So the strategy was never to win a unanimous vote of everybody in the world, nor was it to win every single state. But we knew at the same time that in order to, as I said, get the court to do this, we had to grow a critical mass of states, and we had to grow a critical mass of public opinion. And as you said, when I was doing the world's first ever trial on the freedom to marry, the first time we ever got a day in court that we were denied in the 70s, in the 90s, we got that day in court in Hawaii. And in 1996, we won the world's first ever trial, because we finally got a court willing to actually look at the evidence, hear the arguments, allow us to cross-examine, and show there was no good reason. But we were at 27%. So what it took to get from 27% to the fragile majority we first got in late 09, 2010, was, again, millions of conversations. It was all these different battles that took place during the 90s and the 2000s, some of which we won, some of which we lost, many of which we lost and then learned how to win, and some of which we won and then saw taken away. All this battling, all this engagement sparked millions of conversations which move people's hearts and minds. But you're correct that all that work of the 90s and the 2000s, building on the 70s and the 80s and so on, got us to a majority of the American people. That's, which is still a pretty dramatic change of hearts and minds, to go from 27% in 1996 during the Hawaii case and the passage of the federal anti-gay so-called Defense of Marriage Act to, by 2010, a majority. But what we found in 2010, and we saw this reflected in the losses, we saw California's Proposition 8 pass in a state that everybody thought we could win. We saw the voters in Maine take away the victory we had won in the legislature. So having a fragile majority wasn't enough. We needed to solidify it. And what we found was that the people we hadn't yet gotten by 2010, as we grew from 27 to 50%, were the people who wanted to be fair. They weren't the hardcore anti-gay opposition. But they also didn't understand why do gay people want the freedom to marry. They wanted to be fair, but they just didn't get why marriage. They were what I think of as, quote, the civil union people, the partnership people, the people who said, yes, you should have health coverage. Yes, you should not be attacked. But why marriage? And so we did a huge amount of work, and Freedom to Marry led this coalition of organizations and crunching of 85 data sets, and funders supported a year and a half of serious research. And the aha moment came during the focus groups we were doing. And remember, these were the reachable but not yet reached. They weren't the hardcore opposition, but they weren't the people who supported us. They were the middle. And we asked them, why do you want to get married? What is marriage to you? And the number one answer by far was, love. I get married for love. I get married to show a commitment to the person I love. And then we asked them, and why do you think gay people want to get married? And the number one answer was, I don't know. They couldn't figure it out. And when we squeeze and press, well, what do you think? Why do you think gay people want to get married? You want to get married for love. Why do you think gay people want to get married? The number one answer was maybe health benefits. And so that was the light bulb moment, because we realized people didn't understand that gay people have the same human aspirations to find someone who will put up with us in life, to love us, to love someone, to take care, to make a commitment to that person, to stand in front of family and friends and affirm that commitment. And so what we did from 2010 on was re-emphasize the case we were making in the court of public opinion to not put as much emphasis on the legal and economic consequences of marriage or the constitutional values of fairness and liberty and justice, important as all of those things are, but instead to emphasize the part of the case that these people, the people who hadn't yet come along with us, needed to hear, which was about that love and that commitment and the shared values of treating others with empathy, the golden rule of treating others as you want to be treated. And as we were able to get our movement colleagues and to build a stronger campaign that delivered that authentic part of the message through messengers, including non-gay people, who talked about their family members and the shared values of respect and love, we began picking up those people who hadn't heard that through the battling and the political and the constitution and the benefits discussion. And we went from roughly 50% in 2010 to now, just 5 years later, 63% or more, because those people heard the part that moved their hearts and minds.
And so before you got to that fragile majority, as you call it, there was an unbroken string of states that had passed these constitutional amendments. And you invested in this research that you touched on to try to understand what voters were thinking. How did that change how you conducted these campaigns?
Well, I mean, first of all, to be very clear, this was again, as I said, it was a movement, not a military. You know, there was no one person who could just say to everybody in the country working on this, no matter what state they were in, no matter what organization, do it this way and this is how we're going to win. We had to persuade, we had to coax, we had to build, sometimes people needed to make mistakes and lose before they were willing to, by default, embrace a different strategy. But by 2010, the movement was tired of losing. State leaders, national organizations, national funders who were contributing to the work we were doing had tried everything else. And so they were willing to double down on doing the kind of message engagement and message delivery I talked about, to really try to work together to reach those hearts and minds in different corners of the country. And as we saw the anti-gay side throwing yet more and more attack amendments at us, we had, as you said, we lost about 30. And we saw this strategy led by Karl Rove and the George W. Bush campaign in 2004 to push these anti-gay attack amendments, and then it was picked up by our hardcore opposition, the Family Research Council and the usual suspects of the anti-gay industry, and they targeted more and more states, including, of course, Minnesota in 2012. So as all of this was happening, people were realizing the things we had been doing before weren't good enough. We needed to up our game. We needed to work better. We needed to deliver the right messages. We needed to engage the right messengers. We needed to start earlier to build these campaigns. And Minnesota was the shining example of where the local organizations and local activists here came together early, decided to build a campaign that would really engage Minnesotans in a conversation, not in the last 2 months before they voted in November of 2012, but over a year and a half of having these conversations, knocking on doors, engaging non-gay people to go talk to gay people, to talk about these values, to make the case, to tell the stories, to spark the conversations. And Freedom to Marry and other national organizations were able to partner with local leaders here that included certainly not just gay groups, but businesses and clergy and others across the state to build the right kind of campaign that engaged enough people in enough conversations over enough time to be ready to become what Minnesota did eventually become, the first state to reject one of these anti-gay attacks in 2012, which of course turned out to be a year in which we were able to win 4 out of 4 ballot measures, Minnesota being the lead and being the first one to defeat one of the anti-gay attacks. In the other states, we had ballot measures that affirmed the marriage legislation that we had passed and made it law.
And you came to Minnesota early on to
many times,
and provided support to the campaign. So what did you notice when you came here?
Well, one of the things that was most moving, and it really has stood out as one of the shining moments for me of my 32 years of doing this work, was the campaign had me going around to a set of house parties and to kind of spark this, let's take our campaign to the next level and get more volunteers and so on. And one day it struck me that as I was doing this, and I can't even remember the town, the Minnesota town that we were in, I realized that I was literally the only gay person in that room, in this house, where the house party was being held. The hosts of the house party were not gay. The friends who they had brought in to hear and to hopefully sign up with the campaign were not gay. Even the volunteer who had driven me from my hotel here to go to these round of house parties that day was not gay. And it was just such a beautiful thing. It was just such a testament to what we were trying to achieve, that we were trying to engage the American people in a conversation that was not really primarily about how do you feel about gay people, but it was what kind of person are you? What are your values? What kind of country do we want to have?
And with Minnesota in 2012, as you mentioned, you had 4 states that you won that year. Was the tide just turning, or did Minnesota do something different?
It was both. By 2012, we had built momentum. We had moved a majority. We had grown a majority up from 27% to, as I said, to 50%, and higher by the time we got to 2012. We had, and this was took a lot of deliberate work and pressure and engagement and political organizing and tenacity, we had paved a pathway for the president to embrace the freedom to marry and speak out, which he did. And his speaking out in support of the freedom to marry showed moral leadership that actually gave permission to millions of Americans to think anew and to journey, to evolve, as his phrase was. When the president came out in support of the freedom to marry, it was not only that he did it, but how he did it. If you remember that day, he in that interview on May 9th, 2012, he talked not as the president, not as a lawyer, not as a law professor, not as the commander-in-chief, but as a dad. And he talked about the daughters, his daughters, Malia and Sasha, and how they had said to him and Michelle that they have classmates being raised by gay parents. And they didn't think it was fair that those families be treated differently. And the president said to the American people, and I realized that if I want to teach my kids values like the golden rule, I have to live up to them. Well, that kind of conversation, role modeled by the president, really was what we were seeing and what we were engineering across America. So there was already tremendous momentum. We had grown the number of states. We had already now learned to win states with Republicans as well as Democrats. We'd won in legislatures as well as courts. We'd won in the heartland, Iowa, as well as on the coasts. And yet the barrier we had not overcome was winning an up or down vote of the people in a ballot measure. And so while we had tremendous momentum and had built this campaign and had done so much better after so many losses, Minnesota took all these lessons and, as I said earlier, did it right. The campaign came together here early. The local advocates, the local organizations swallowed their differences and worked together. They hired a strong campaign manager, Richard Carlbaum here, a former local mayor at the age of 26, who had gone on to lead this campaign and done such a great job that actually Freedom to Marry hired him afterwards to be our national director of state campaigns. And he played that role for us up until we won in court a few months ago. The local fundraising was enormous. The vast bulk of the money that was raised here in state. Businesses that had previously gotten it wrong or ducked actually moved and came out in support and did the right thing and contributed not only their money but their message that this that voting no at that point on this anti-gay attack was essential for Minnesota's health, not just for their gay people here. So there were Minnesota was riding the momentum that we were building and the progress we were making, but also did all the right elements and did the right thing to run the right kind of campaign that then redoubled that momentum as we then headed toward the Supreme Court, which had always been the ultimate goal of the strategy.
And we should jump ahead to that ruling. So in June of this year, can you describe the moment when you got the news that the Supreme Court had granted the right to marry to gay couples in all 50 states?
Absolutely. So again, this is something, this was what we had always been working toward. The strategy was always, we want to win in the Supreme Court once we have built a critical mass of states, including by then Minnesota, and a critical mass of public support. And so we were feeling very, very hopeful. We believed we had built that critical mass. We believed we had been able to make the case not only to the court, but to the country, that America is ready and that it was time and that the justices needed to do this because too many people were now being left out, even as the majority of the country and the majority of the states at that point had embraced the freedom to marry. So we believed that we were going to win. We were very, very hopeful. But of course, you never know for sure, and we worked relentlessly until that day, and it was a Friday when, after several days of gathering my team and coming into the staff and to the conference room in our national headquarters in New York, and we did our little checklist of, is everybody ready to go? Are we ready to do our pushing out the FAQs? Are we ready to share the information with the media? Are we ready to work with local organizations so they can help guide people to implement the victory, if that's what we have, or mobilize people in the event of it not being a victory? We've now done this drill several times because you never know for sure which day it's going to be. So on Monday, on Thursday, et cetera. But Friday, June 26, we gathered again. And although we didn't know for sure it was going to be the day, there were only 2 days left, so our odds were good. And June 26 had special historic resonance because it was the day on which two of the previous major gay rights rulings had come down. So for no scientific reason, but for reasons of civil rights karma, there was this added degree of tension because we kind of believed it was going to be this day. So as 10 o'clock drew near when the Supreme Court was going to convene, I had all of my New York team there. We have other staff members and organizers around the country, but the New York team was gathered in the conference room in our headquarters, and everybody, of course, had their devices, their iPhones, their laptops, et cetera, et cetera. And even though at Freedom to Marry, I had this amazing, extraordinary team of young activists who were the digital cutting edge of this and pretty much every other movement, the envy of other movements that we, that was part of the really great work Freedom to Marry did through these young, talented activists and staffers, I was the one who saw it first on my device. And I said, oh my God, we won. And then I got very nervous because I realized when I say it, people are going to take it very, very seriously. And I didn't know for sure that we had won. But within nanoseconds, it started flooding across everybody's blogs and tweets and Facebook and so on. And so we immediately did a toast. We were prepared from all these days of having gathered with champagne. We did a quick toast. And then everybody ran to their battle stations to begin pushing it out and responding and solidifying this win and getting it out there. And my job was to go back to my office and read the opinion. So as I sat at my desk scrolling through the opinion, I found myself crying. Because after 32 years, every paragraph of this opinion brought back memories, brought back associations. I thought of email exchanges with Jack Baker and Michael McConnell. I thought of all these other pioneers, some of whom didn't live to see it. I thought of the battles we had fought in states from Minnesota to Mississippi. I thought of arguments I'd had with colleagues about, let's not do this, let's not, it's not the right idea, it's not the right time. I thought of all the ups and downs and struggles, and things that Justice Kennedy wrote reminded me of things I had written as a law student. I remembered arguments and so on. So it was just this flood of memories and associations as I just took in this joyous triumph. But I realized actually two days later that although that was part of why I was crying, it wasn't the whole reason, that I also was crying because of relief. And I realized 2 days later that, you know, I always believed we were going to win. And I truly always believed it. It wasn't spin. I just stuck with it and believed it and kept believing it. And I was the one who had to keep conveying that. And fortunately for me, it was genuine. I believed we could win through all the ups and downs and battles and losses. And I also believed that if we hadn't won that day, we would have kept working our smart, good strategy, and we would have won. But boy, was I happy not to have to do that, to be able to finally lay it down and to have won. And the fact that it even took me 2 days to realize that that very human relief was something I was feeling was also a little bit of a meta example of how in mode I had been, how hardened in this work I had been in order to be able to keep driving through the ups and downs and losses of these decades of, quote, overnight victory.
Well, questions are pouring in, so I'm going to start reading them.
Okay.
Here's the first one. You use the phrase anti-gay industry. Has your experience given you any special insight into the motivations of that industry, fierce as it is slash was? And if so, did that influence the movement's strategy?
Well, first, to be very clear, I always distinguished, and fortunately we always distinguished, well, we almost always distinguished, between the hardcore opponents, on the one hand, and the people who were not yet with us. There are bigots out there. There are anti-gay hardcore opponents who are driven either by their own hardcore anti-gay ideology or by their exploitative political agendas. But not everybody who wasn't with us was one of them. And I always believed we needed to not allow the hardcore opposition to be the focus of our attention in a way that distracted us from the real work of actually engaging the people who were not yet with us but who were movable. And so the real story of the movement and the movement's success, and certainly the work of the Freedom to Marry campaign and our partners, was to find a way to engage that middle and not get distracted by the opposition. Now, of course, we had to pay attention to what the opposition was doing, but they were not as important to me as reaching the majority of the American people, reaching the middle, reaching the parts of the American people we had not yet reached but needed to figure out and adapt and think about what they needed to understand in order to get them. So that's sort of a long way of saying that I actually don't really so much care what motivates the most fanatic, the most extreme, the most hardcore, the most out of step with history of our opposition, the Tony Perkinses, the Mike Huckabees, and so on. They're going to do what they're going to do, and they're going to strut their moment on the stage, and history will not look kindly on them any more than it looked kindly on the Bull Connors and the Strom Thurmonds and the others who were on the wrong side of history. But I feel like we don't need to get caught up in that negative place when the positive story here is we can reach our neighbors, we can move the American people. And what I find so moving about this is that this was an American victory. We all won. People moved. We didn't just win something in the law. We changed hearts and minds. The American people proved willing to open their eyes, open their hearts, and move.
This person says, not to make you craft all campaign tactics, but while fairness seems to apply to the move for other types of equality, employment, housing, et cetera, it seems to move to broader equality. It seems the move to broader equality will take a shift in strategy. Can you talk about how to win those goals?
Well, so I would say that I'm a big believer, and I think one of the things we got right in these decades of work and in this combination of movement, strategy, and campaign, I'm a big believer in what I think of as the ladder of clarity. you want to be clear first and foremost about what is your goal. And you want to be able to state it in a way that people can respond to it, be inspired by it, rise to it, and contribute to it. You want to be clear, working down the ladder, about your strategy. What will it take to achieve your goal? And Freedom to Marry was always about the strategy. We talked endlessly about the strategy. It was never a secret strategy. We had it on our website. We wanted people to know how we were going to win. And we didn't care if the opposition, quote unquote, knew our strategy. We wanted people to know what it was going to take to win. And clarity about the vehicles. If your strategy calls for building a critical mass of states and a critical mass of support, how are you going to win this state? How are you going to win that state? How are you going to do it by litigation or by legislation? And if you needed to do it by ballot measure, how are you going to learn to do it by ballot measure? And if you needed to move a majority of the American people up from 27%, how are you going to make that case? What are you going to say to help people understand how this affects women, how it affects Latinos, how it affects African Americans, how it affects people of faith, how it affects young people, how it affects rural people, et cetera. And you need to have clarity on that fourth rung of the ladder of action steps. And so we were able to, I think, to really be very good at putting all of these things forward. So when you look at the next goals of our movement, you know, we've won the Freedom to Marry, an epic triumph, a huge transformation. Now, we've won it as a matter of law. The marriage conversation has only just arrived. So the first thing our movement really needs to do is not pivot away from the Freedom to Marry, but engage the conversation around marriage, this powerful engine of helping people see families and see shared values, which will do tremendous work, as it has in moving a majority of the country, can now engage people in parts of the country where the marriage conversation has only just arrived and where we need to do a lot of heavy lifting. We want them to have the same opportunity to see what Minnesotans have seen for the last 3 years. So the first thing we want to do is engage that marriage conversation and build on it and harness it to the legal and political work ahead. But there are important legal and political pieces of work that are not achieved by winning the Freedom to Marry. And so those are the next goals of this movement. For example, we do not have federal civil rights protection that prohibits discrimination on the basis of gender identity or sexual orientation in the workplace, in employment, in housing, in public accommodations like stores and theaters. And we need that federal civil rights law. We need more state and local measures, as you have here in Minnesota, but that too many parts of the country do not have. So we need those federal bills, state bills, local bills to prohibit discrimination and give guidance to businesses and others as to how to conduct themselves. So if that's your goal, you then shape a strategy that achieves that goal. You don't just say the Freedom to Marry strategy was to do X, so we're going to do X to do that. We have a playbook of different things that worked and different ways to do these things. We have a model of using a strategy, but the exact strategy has to be tailored to the goals.
So you mentioned Richard Carlbaum, who led the campaign here, and he's down in Houston tonight.
Exactly.
Trying to block the repeal of the Houston Equal Rights Ordinance. So there are those kinds of battles going on, and you know, so Minnesota did it the other way around, where the Human Rights Act was modified in 93, and so the argument about now a baker will have to bake a cake for a gay couple was moot because they already had to bake the cake. You couldn't deny somebody public accommodation here. But so other states now are going to be, they have marriage, and then now the campaign will be for equal protection. And so, but yet a lot of people don't seem to know that protection isn't there.
Right. Well, so that's an example of why I wouldn't say here's how the Freedom to Marry strategy exactly achieves non-discrimination, because the goal requires a different tailoring of strategy. It does require a strategy, but it requires not the exact same strategy. So with the Freedom to Marry, we had to build a critical mass of support. We, as I said, when we won that first ruling in 1996, we were at 27%. We already have upwards of 80% support in the country for non-discrimination laws. People in the abstract understand that, as Minnesota has done, as Minneapolis and St. Paul have done, as so many jurisdictions around the country have done, It's important to protect people against discrimination in employment and housing and restaurants and theaters and so on, and it works. It's good for business, it's good for the economy, it's good for people, it works. So the vast majority of the American people already understand that. We don't have to change people's hearts and minds in the way that we did with marriage. But what we do have to do is help people understand the law isn't there. That's not what the law says in most of these states and in many of the cities. And it's not what the federal law says. So the work is in getting people to understand that the law is not where it needs to be. And then we need to enable people to push back against the kinds of scare tactics and distractions and also complacency that are the enemies of change. So for example, our opponents don't get out there and say there shouldn't be non-discrimination laws. No, they come up with scare tactics like men are going to be running into women's bathrooms and attacking young children. That's obviously an emotional hot button scare tactic that has nothing to do with the non-discrimination law that we know from states like Minnesota isn't what happens. We know this isn't what happens in track record and track record and track record across the country, but this is a political campaign, so they throw the scare tactics. So what we need to do as a movement is build the kinds of conversations and engagement that help people understand that their values and support for non-discrimination measures are not reflected in the law, that the law needs to be enacted, that there is a clear answer to the kinds of scare tactics that the right wing is going to throw up, and that there's a track record of success supported by businesses and others because they understand that non-discrimination actually is good for the community, for the country, for the economy, and for people. So that's the work that we have to do going forward. It's the work that Richard Carlbaum, as you said, is leading right now in Houston. They're voting tomorrow. If you haven't donated yet, go home tonight and donate to this campaign because we want to keep those ads on the airwaves to push back against the scare tactic ads that the right wing has been throwing out there. That's the way we lost so many of those ballot measures before we got our act together and figured out how to engage the public opinion and move, help people understand and assemble the business coalitions. And if we don't win in Houston tomorrow, it's going to be a little lesson about the work we need to do better as we seize the opportunities to move forward in the years ahead.
This is another question from the audience. Does the court always follow or does it sometimes lead? And if it's the latter, what factors are relevant? When is optimizing a critical mass not needed?
Yeah, so the court, look, in the abstract, the whole idea of building public opinion and winning states in order to get the Constitution enforced is not what we learned in high school, right? It's not what we learned in civic. It's not the way it's, quote, supposed to work. The way it's supposed to work is you look at the Constitution, you have a guarantee, you're not supposed to have to put it up to a vote, you're not supposed to have to build public opinion, courts are not supposed to take account of public opinion, they should just enforce the law. Well, that's the way it's supposed to be, but it's not the way it is, history tells us. And so, in general, we understood that in our strategy, in order to get the court to do right in 2015, what it didn't do right in 1972, we needed to build this critical mass of states and critical mass of public support to maximize our chances of winning. But at the same time, there are other things that go into it, like who are the justices? What president is appointing what kind of justices? And what do those justices think and feel, and what are their passions, what are their prejudices, what are the influences on their looking at the law? Now, would they say their passions and prejudices? No, they would say they're doing an objective job of looking at the law. But as human beings, they're human beings. So you do everything you can to maximize your chances of winning. And then there will still be examples of time where the courts have the courage to not just look at public opinion, but to do what they believe is the right thing to do under the Constitution and the law. So for example, when the court struck down race restrictions on who could marry whom in the United States in 1967, the best named case ever, Loving versus Virginia, in that case, 70% of the American people were opposed to interracial marriage, but the court had the courage to do it anyway. They did the right thing. But in 1972, when Jack Baker and Michael McConnell came out of Minnesota asking for that same freedom to marry, the court didn't have the courage and the clarity to do it. So we did everything we could to maximize our chances of winning. And at the end of the day, there are still going to be factors that are not going to be in your control, like which judge sits on the court. So, for example, and I'm sorry this is a long answer, but for example, when we hosted at Freedom to Marry, we hosted a victory celebration. We had over 1,000 activists and supporters and people committed to the Freedom to Marry who came together in New York 2 weeks after the victory and celebrated. And we showed the video that we began this program with. And we had as our special guest who wanted to be there, who asked to come and be there, the Vice President of the United States, Joe Biden. And he saluted Freedom to Marry. He saluted the work of this movement. He saluted the achievement of the country. And one of the things we talked about that night was when before Joe Biden was Vice President, he had been chair of the Judiciary Committee. And as chair of the Judiciary Committee in the United States Senate, he had presided over the debate around the Supreme Court nomination made by Ronald Reagan of a judge who Reagan hoped to elevate to the Supreme Court named Robert Bork. And Joe Biden had led the effort to defeat that dangerous nomination. The judge who was nominated by Reagan to take that seat after Bork was rejected was Anthony Kennedy, who wrote the opinion in 2015. Had it not been for that battle, had we not prevailed back in 1987, that 2015 vote would have looked very different. Now, did I have some master strategy that pulled that all together every inch and step of the way? Of course not.
Here's another question from the audience. Would you talk about current efforts to argue that business owners who oppose same-sex marriage should not be compelled, say, to bake a cake for a gay wedding? Part two of that question is, what are the legal, political, ethical arguments to such people, or do we just not worry about them?
The classic pattern of civil rights advance in the United States over many decades now is that when opponents of civil rights fail to block a civil rights law, fail to stop the enactment of a step forward, they then try to subvert it. They try to undermine it. If they couldn't stop it, they try to undermine it. And one of the most common tactics we've seen used in this effort to subvert civil rights progress is to cloak the desire not to comply with the law under the banner of religious freedom. We saw it in the 50s, we saw it in the 60s, we saw it in the 70s and the 80s with women's advance. We're seeing it again now. This is not a new idea, it's not a new battle, it's not a new claim. But fortunately, the American people have actually always understood that there is no true conflict between non-discrimination and civil rights in the economic arenas, in the public arenas, and religious freedom and people's absolute right to believe whatever they want to believe, say whatever they want to say, but also still follow the law that keeps us together as a civil society. And so a baker or anyone else is absolutely free to have his or her views, to not want gay people to be able to marry, to not want Jews to be able to marry, to not want to serve African Americans or whatever. They have every right to believe these things. But what they don't have the right to do is to open their doors to the public, saying we will serve the public, and then refuse to serve members of the public based on race, religion, sex, sexual orientation, national origin, and so on. When you step into the marketplace, when you open up a business to the public, you serve the public. And again, I think the American people actually understand that. Poll after poll, battle after battle, we see that the American people understand that that's the essence of our democracy. That's how we preserve both religious freedom and opportunity and a cohesive democratic society. If you start making any person's desire to discriminate part of what they're able to do just by saying the magic word religion, and then no one can second guess it, it's just, you just say, I don't want to follow the law, it's my religion, we won't have a society. We won't have a democracy. And we certainly won't have the kind of progress we've made in bringing into our country's promise people of different races, men and women, people of gay and lesbian and bisexual and transgender orientation and identity. And that's not the right answer for America. And by the way, it's not just someone like me saying this. The biggest loss our movement ever had in court came in 1986, when the Supreme Court, by a vote of 5-4, upheld laws that said that gay people could be arrested in their own bedroom for having private consensual sex with other adults. That was later overturned. The name of that case, the biggest defeat we ever had, was Bowers v. Hardwick. Michael Bowers was then the Attorney General of Georgia. Michael Bowers today issued one of the strongest statements explaining that these kinds of religious exemptions, these licenses to discriminate, are a subterfuge for discrimination and are a can of worms that would undermine the rule of law for everybody and cannot be tolerated. If Michael Bowers can understand that, I'm confident that even the legislators in some of these states playing with fire near our Constitution can also come to understand it.
A couple of questions about the transgender community. How can the trans community win full equality in American society? What can we learn from the successful fight for marriage? What won't apply?
Well, I think we've seen tremendous progress already. America is actually now having a conversation about trans people and about how trans people are, again, not some alien others who came from God knows where, but actually are a part of our families. They are our brothers, our sisters, our mothers, our fathers. They are our coworkers. And as people have those conversations, hearts and minds open and people move. And the majority of the American people today understand that discriminating against people because they are transgender is wrong. What we need to do is make sure that the troglodyte politicians, who too often are out of touch with the American people's good wisdom, stop pandering to the dwindling base of people who oppose civil rights progress, and instead reflect the understanding of the American people and the understanding of business and others that it's wrong to discriminate, and that gender identity protections, where they exist in law in many states and cities, and now increasingly in federal law as courts are beginning to rule against this kind of discrimination, actually, again, helps people without hurting anyone. So I think the biggest lesson that the marriage success offers to our parallel and overlapping work to end gender identity discrimination is we need to help people understand heart to heart, people to people, that who trans people are, and the non-trans people who love them and work with them and share the values and desires to make sure that everybody's treated with respect, and that when we treat people with respect and when the law protects people, nobody loses. And I think as we have those millions of conversations, and happily America is in a moment of that conversation really ratcheting up, in part thanks to the political and legal organizing that the trans community and the broader lesbian and gay and bisexual and trans movement have made. There's been a tremendous amount of work on behalf of gay organizations in support of trans causes. And we're seeing increasing leadership and engagement with non-gay and non-trans allies. We've seen the courts, we've seen the EEOC, the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, rule in favor of gender identity protections. We've seen the Obama administration, just in the last couple weeks, issue executive orders and take legal positions, making clear that a proper understanding of federal law prohibits this kind of discrimination. So we're gonna have to keep doing that and keep doing more of that, and I think the key lesson from the marriage work is make it personal, make it authentic, make it aspirational, engage with people and help them rise to fairness. Don't just assume they can't get there.
This is a question about DOMA. Was signing DOMA a necessary strategic move to avoid a constitutional amendment as asserted by the Clintons?
No.
Anything more to say about that?
I think the I mean, obviously this has been a flap over the last 10 days, 2 weeks, and what I've said publicly and others have said is that it is not true that that's why DOMA was proposed, it is not true why it was passed, and it is not true why President Clinton chose to sign it back in 1996. So it's not right to misstate the history. But what's even more important is that Secretary Clinton, Senator Sanders, and many other politicians, including others, including even some Republicans, though none of the ones running for president yet, but other important Republican office holders, have moved. And the 1996 was a very different point in this battle. And I don't think there's any shame in people saying, I was wrong before, I didn't understand it, I didn't do the right thing, whether out of political calculation or lack of courage or lack of understanding, and I've changed my mind. I think it's okay to say that, and I think we need to allow our political leaders to say that because we want them to change their mind and do the right thing. So I think people should not misstate the history, but I do think what really counts now is where are they now. And happily, Secretary Clinton, Senator Sanders are strong supporters of not only gay people, but transgender people and the broader causes of human rights and proper legal protections. And we need to hold their feet to the fire, but we also need to recognize and applaud that progress and encourage others to follow that good example.
For a number of reasons.
And let me just add that, since we're there, Freedom to Marry is a nonpartisan organization. We do not endorse candidates. We are an equal opportunity cheerleader or critic for any politician or any party, depending on whether they're on the right side or the wrong side and whether they're moving in the right direction or the wrong direction.
Okay. For a number of reasons, pursuing a court case in Minnesota was a bad idea. Were there other states in which a judicial remedy was also ill-advised?
Well, there were many states in which we believed it was the right strategy to go to court and where we thought we would win and where people were very invested in saying we wouldn't be able to win legislatively, so maybe we needed to shape a legal strategy. And some of those states that we thought we were going to win legally, we didn't. And we had to learn how to go to the legislature and make the case, and in some cases we had to learn how to go to the ballot measure. I think what's important is you want to do the best you can in making a strategic analysis, not out of fear, but out of really looking at, you know, what is the composition of the court, what is the case law, case law around the constitutional guarantees that we will be able to get the judges to do the right thing. But even after you do all that analysis, you also need to do the bigger analysis, because this is really the key to winning, whether it's through the litigation or legislation or ballot measure, any of the methodologies, is how are you going to create the climate to win? And so even if you're doing a litigation strategy, you still need to do public education. You still need to do organizing. You still need to engage the business community. You still need to have those heart-to-heart conversations with neighbors. You still need to get non-gay people to talk about gay people, et cetera, you know, and other similar parallel things. So let me just give you an example of what I mean. I mean, the biggest example, of course, is Jack Baker and Michael McConnell lost in 1972. As you mentioned, the court didn't even bother to write an opinion. They just threw him out of court. They wrote one sentence. There's no claim here. And that was that. And that sentence sat on the law books until we overturned it in June of this year, 40 plus years later, right? It's not because they didn't have the right legal arguments, it's because the country wasn't ready. In the last 2 years, from 2013 till our victory in June, we won 70 court rulings in courts all across the country, federal courts as well as state courts, appellate courts as well as trial courts, judges appointed by Republicans as well as judges appointed by Democrats. 70 courts saw what the Supreme Court did not see in 1972 and ruled in favor of the freedom to marry. In all of those rulings, my favorite passage was in the case in which we brought the freedom to marry to Utah. Ruby red Utah, most conservative state in the country, most religious state in the country. And in that freedom to marry victory in Utah, the judge wrote, quote, "It's not the Constitution that has changed. It's our knowledge of what it means to be lesbian or gay." And in that sentence, that judge in Utah captured the strategy and captured the history of how we won. The Constitution was always there. We had to get them to see it.
A couple of questions sort of looking ahead. One person says, "We started working on gay rights at the Washington March in 1987. What type of activism can we be working on at this point in our history? And somebody else says, what's left to be done now that we have equal marriage? Is this it?
Right. Well, so I touched on this earlier. While we have one marriage in the law, the marriage conversation has only just arrived. We know it's a powerful engine. It moved the country from 27% to 63%. Let's not stop there. It moved Minnesota from opposition to support. We have other states. We have other parts in the country. We need to harness the power of this engine, of this conversation, to continue growing understanding and support for gay people and transgender people and our involvement and engagement in our families and our communities in every part of the country. And we still have these legal and political goals that are not met. The federal civil rights law I talked about, state and local measures. But at the end of the day, of course, it's also not just about legal and political progress. We don't just want good laws, we want good lives. And so the work we have to do is not only about supporting organizations and pulling together alliances and crafting and adapting strategies to achieve legal and political battles and to fight back against the kinds of attacks and regression and efforts to subvert it that we talked about, which we also have to do. Vigilance is part of liberty, as they say. But we also need to engage the culture. We need to engage in the personal. We need to make sure that every young person, every gay person, every trans person growing up as a kid, no matter where they are, grow up healthy and secure and feeling safe and able to go to school and able to dream big. We need to make sure that these young people in all parts of the country are not suffering from the isolation and exclusion and hostility of their own family, of their own community, of their own school, of their own church. And we need to make sure that gay and trans people as we age, that older gay people and trans people are not forced back into the closet because they can't find support or facilities who will respect them and allow them to have the lives of dignity as they openly want to be. That's not just legal and political work, that's cultural and community engagement. So there's a lot more left to do, and we are far from done. And the victory is never fully won because there's always more to do and to build on it. And the victory, particularly a victory as resonant as winning the freedom to marry, can be a gift that keeps on giving as long as we keep engaging it and taking it and putting it to further use.
So you're trying to work yourself out of a job at Freedom to Marry. So what will be next for you?
So I have worked myself out of a job at Freedom to Marry. We are in the process now of winding down Freedom to Marry. Freedom to Marry was created not as another organization. We have important organizations that must keep going because of all the work I just described. But Freedom to Marry was built as a campaign to drive a strategy and to bring together organizations to get this job done. And our job is done. So Freedom to Marry is winding down. And early next year, early 2016, I will be out of a job. And that's always been the goal. I don't know what I'm going to do next. I haven't really committed to that yet. I'm going to allow myself to, on the one hand, be of immediate use to whatever other movements, other causes, and other parts of our own broader movement that want to hear these lessons and want to take the advice and figure out how to engage and build on this progress. And I feel like I do have some of that to offer over the next period of time. And while offering and being of assistance immediately, I feel like that'll give me the chance to learn more about other causes and other movements and other parts of our own work that I haven't been as focused on because I've been focused for 32 years on winning the freedom to marry. I don't think you can immediately take one cookie cutter model and say this is exactly what you're gonna do next to win voting rights and reproductive rights and gun control and a whole variety of global human rights. I feel like I have a contribution to make to that, and while I'm making that contribution, I can learn, and as I'm learning, I'll then see what I want to spend the next big 20 or 30 year chapter of my life battling, but I don't know that yet.
So in those movements that are coming to you, what kinds of lessons can be applied?
So I do think some of the lessons that we even talked about tonight are, they sound like basic and obvious, and I think they are. They're not rocket science. And yet, they are not something that every movement or every activist necessarily has fully put forward yet. This ladder of clarity, clarity of goal, clarity of strategy, clarity of vehicles and programs, clarity of action steps. It's very basic, but many movements could do better in applying that. The way in which as a campaign, we were able to do a synergy amongst national work of climate creation, federal work of addressing the Supreme Court, the President, the Congress through different approaches, and state work to build that critical mass of state, that synergy of national, federal, and state is something that I think many movements can adapt to the strategy of pursuing their goal. The nonpartisan outreach, the success we had in working across party lines and in bringing in unexpected and even surprising supporters, conservatives, religious, Republicans, people who are older, the people, the categories that had been the most resistant, we worked hard to figure out how do we bring them along. The storytelling strategies and message delivery and messenger engagement and message crafting that we did through many stumbles and imperfections is a model to be looked at and applied in other causes and battles and movements. And I would add fundraising. We'd actually, by historical terms, and when you compare it to what other political battles have cost, this didn't really cost that much. But out of your and my salary, it was quite a lot. I mean, this was well over $160 million over all these years and decades and battles and struggle. Now, that's not a huge amount when you talk about moving a country of 320 million people from one position to another with all the kinds of political battles and lines we had to face, but it's still a lot of work to raise that money, and campaigns need money. So the strategies and tactics and the kind of leadership examples we saw from individual donors and from foundations and from some big donors, but also many, 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 many small donors, is something to be looked at and thought about as movements build their machines and do their work. And again, I'll just end with where I began. The combination, the synergy of movement, strategy, and campaign, that it took all of those. It took grassroots engagement. It took millions of individuals getting mobilized and inspired and empowered to contribute their piece, but that wasn't enough either. It also needed a central campaign. It needed strong organizations. It needed a clear strategy that could hold all of that together.
A couple last questions here. Are we going to see Mary Bonato on the Supreme Court?
I hope so. It would be a wonderful appointment. I don't know that Mary's necessarily putting her name forward, but Mary would certainly be a wonderful judge and deserves to be on the Supreme Court, and it would be wonderful to see that. Some of the other civil rights pioneers of our movement and the marriage leaders of our movement have made their way to judicial office. One of the justices of the Vermont Supreme Court is a woman named Beth Robinson, who was co-counsel along with Mary and was the leader of our work to win the freedom to marry in Vermont that resulted in civil union. She now sits on the Vermont Supreme Court. The non-gay man who played the pivotal role of bringing the case in Hawaii, the case that more than any other single case shaped the arc of this victory and launched this ongoing global movement back in the 90s, non-gay attorney Dan Foley now sits on the Hawaii courts. So there is precedent, and I strongly encourage President Obama or whoever the next president is, and part of our jobs has to be to elect the right kind of president who will make the right kind of appointment, Mary would be a great candidate.
I wanted to ask actually about the path of states. You mentioned Hawaii, and then we jumped to the Northeast, and the Northeast states were really the critical mass. And you tried California, and then of course Prop 8, but then Iowa. Like, did that one come out of nowhere for you, or what was that? All of a sudden, in the middle of the country, there was one.
Yeah, well, no, none of these things, maybe some of these things, but none of the things you just mentioned came out of nowhere. These were all parts of hard work and serious ground effort and engagement and preparation. There were cases brought in numerous states, Iowa being one of them, by these pillar organizations, the legal organizations in our movement. That Iowa was brought by Lambda Legal, but there's GLAAD in Massachusetts, Mary's organization. There's the Lambda Legal, there's the ACLU, and there's the National Center for Lesbian Rights that brought the case in California along with some of the others. All of these things were, all the ones we just mentioned, were thought out and strategic, and groundwork was laid. And when, for example, in Iowa, when Lambda brought the case, Freedom to Marry, together with a group of funders called the Civil Marriage Collaborative and a group of local organizations, pulled together a campaign to, again, create the climate in Iowa, not only to enable the Iowa Supreme Court to make its historic ruling back in April of 2009, but to actually hold that victory, something we hadn't been able to do in California. And we held that victory against efforts to take it away by constitutional amendment in Iowa. So none of these things were, or none of the successful things were in isolation or just out of nowhere. On the other hand, they weren't under 100% control either, and things happen. It's a movement, not a military.
No, just Iowa was interesting because it was ahead of public opinion when the court made
yes,
that ruling.
Yes, that's correct. And we had brought other cases in other states, some of which we also hoped would be icebreakers that would help engage public opinion and move public opinion, but some of those lost. Iowa happened to be one of the ones that won.
This one is maybe a little off topic, but we'll try it anyway. Today, justices heard arguments in Foster and Chapman, which focuses on racial bias and jury selection. You authored an amicus brief in the last such case 30 years ago, Batson versus Kentucky. Do you think the court needs to or will attempt to bring greater clarity to this question?
Yes. Certainly the fact that there still is persistent bias, not only race bias, but sexual orientation bias in the judicial system means that the law and the enforcement of the law and the mechanisms are not where they need to be. I think the issue is in the Batson case, the case I worked on as a young attorney that basically outlawed, according to the Supreme Court, outlawed race-based peremptory challenges, said you cannot strike potential jurors on the basis of their race. And that principle has since been extended to other important classifications, such as sex and sexual orientation and so on. What the Supreme Court said there was right. The problem is, how do you enforce it? How do you make it real? How do you make its promise actually effective in the courts of law, and then make that visible enough that it resonates throughout the criminal justice system and that the public has confidence, including members of the public who are parts of communities who experience police abuse or problems or a sense of injustice. So obviously the law is not yet where it needs to be, and the broader work of enforcing the law, not only as a technical matter, but as a lived matter, is not where it needs to be. That said, I was on a plane all day today, so I don't know what the Supreme Court did or didn't do today, so I can't really comment on that.
Okay. Any closing thoughts?
I think the single biggest thing we did get right, and by we, I mean the campaign Freedom to Marry, but I also mean this movement, is we never gave up. We believed in a vision of America, and we made our case, and we took our hits, we took our losses, we didn't write people off, we believed people could change, and we went out there and we changed them. And the power of America and the luck we have in living in a country with all its flaws and all the problems and all of it not being where it needs to be is we do have a country, we have a court system, we have a constitution, we have a culture in which we can change things. And the number one step, the most important thing, is to actually believe you can do it and keep believing. And don't let them tell you you can't, and don't spend your time cataloging all the problems. Find the pathway and bring others along. And if we can do it here, we can do it on all the other work that still lies ahead.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're going to have the chance to applaud again in a second, because I want to say a few things. First, I want to thank Evan and Sasha for a really great, fascinating discussion and so insightful. But as you were talking, I was, you know, this is, after all, the School of Public Affairs, and we train people for careers in public life. We got 6 different degree programs. Our graduates go into the non-governmental community, they go into government. they go in some go into research, academia. The one unifying theme for all of our students is that they want to spend their careers in public life. In public life, that's how they want to spend their professional lives. And there's a lot of varying views on the issues of the day, and politics affects. Not affects our work here, but it seems to me there were four words you used in various parts of your conversation: alienation, discrimination, exclusion, and intolerance. And I kind of think that if there's one element that all of our students and our community can unite on, it's that for those of us who are going to be in public life, the relentless effort to combat those ills wherever they exist, and using all the power of public life to combat those ills, there's got to be a unanimous agreement that is a noble undertaking. And I think that's the legacy of this institution, of our namesake. And I think this reminder, this reminder of that mission, I think, is extremely valuable in this particular institution. So thank you very much, and please join me again in thanking our Evan and Sasha.
Thank you.